previously on Global Ventures.
We just landed here in Managua, Nicaragua, and we're in the airport, but I've got to say goodbye to the boys. And I'm going to go and fly in another plane and go way up near the Mosquito Coast.
Having to say goodbye to John right away was a little bit difficult.
Love you guys. After saying goodbye to Martine and the boys, we went on down to check in.
I hope I don't grow up, guys.
We see this little plane sitting there, and I'm thinking in my mind, there's no way that we're getting on this.
All it has is like one propeller in the front and two wings.
This is my last will and testament, because the plane about to get on.
Airplane, unbelievably small. One prop. Two pilots that you could reach out and touch, smallest plane I've ever been on, and a third world country. All those things coming together, a little bit scary.
That just screams adventure to me. I'm like, yeah, let's get on the plane. That's really tiny, and it's held together by duct tape.
I'm pretty excited until I just looked at your window and saw all the cracks in it. Now I'm a little freaked out.
If the propeller breaks or one of those wings fly off, that's it. There's no parachutes, which there totally should have been.
It's like the wind's just taking you everywhere.
I kept waiting for the in-flight service to come and, you know, for me to get some apple juice, but it never came.
I'm actually legitimately scared for my life right now. It's not a joke.
We just got off our 3-hour voyage of death, and now I don't know where we're going. We're gonna take a riverboat somewhere. That's all they told me. So I'm ready to be there.
After flying here to Puertas Cabezas, we found out we're gonna have to drive up to this little town called Waspam.
And we will be there at my home until since they notified me that there is no gas in Waspam, we have to take the gas with us.
We're getting so remote that they don't even have any gasoline in the whole town.
You've never gone down the river, and this is a remote area. Has the gospel really gone forth in this area at all?
No, I think that really is a real remote area. The gospel hasn't been in that real there. It's just a lot of religious people, and the Catholic Church is what there.
Gotcha.
We get to Pastor Earl's house, who was the pastor that we were going down the river with, and he had an American there, and he started telling us some pretty weird things.
So do you guys know very much about the river?
No, not at all. You've been up or down or?
Yeah, I've been up 2 or 3 times, but a lot of witchcraft and a lot of demonic presence in the area. They believe in something called greasy sickness, and they'll start losing control of themselves, and they'll get like demonic powers, and it's just describing a possession. They believe in mermaids. Basically, anytime someone drowns on the river, they blame the mermaid.
They really believe that?
100%. Almost anybody in a community.
They believe it's like
argue.
A spiritual or demonic type?
They believe it's demonic, yeah.
They believe mermaids, killer mermaids are real and will drag you into the water and take your life?
They believe in a little dwarf, demonic dwarf thing that lives out in the woods that basically communicates between devils and witches.
We ask him, well, is it a real dwarf person or is it just some kind of spiritual thing? And he's like, I don't know.
There's a lot of other things.
Have you ever seen anything like that? Or someone that really believes in a little dwarf thing, huh?
They all really believe in the little dwarf thing too.
Crazy stuff. People practice in all forms of witchcraft. I just knew they genuinely have no knowledge of really the light and the power of Jesus Christ.
Deep in the heart and the soul of every human being, there's that nagging fear that they have not done enough because no one can do enough.
If you want this freedom through Jesus, we can give it to you right now. We're going to lift you up.
Look, he's bending at the knee. Look at this. Look at this.
The greatest thing that I could have given him that day is Jesus.
woke up really early that morning, like 5 o'clock.
Well, Sir John, can you put up that rope there for me?
Yes, sir. Got it.
Yeah.
It's all the way in.
So there's only been a couple of times in all my missions work that I've been able to go up or down a river to reach remote people groups. The last time was about 15 years ago down in the Amazon region of Peru. So already here, going down this river in Nicaragua, I can tell we're really, really going to a remote area. It's really gonna be cool to be able to connect with these people and minister. There's shallow points already in the river where, yeah, wait, why are we stopping?
I looked back at the boat driver and he was back there with a little pail and he was scooping all the water out of the back of the boat. And so I thought, you know, very beginning of our trip, we're stranded.
Normally you get dirty in the motor, so they got to clean it out, then they get it again. It's like garbage from the river.
Gotcha.
I guess they had to clean all the dirt out of the motor and scoop water out of the back of the boat before we could go again.
You know this, Honduras, Nicaragua.
Oh, Honduras.
Honduras, Nicaragua. Yeah. Whoa. We're right here on the border.
Yeah.
Very cool.
I'm counting that. I've been to Honduras.
The first village we got to, it was really cool because you stop your boat and then all the people from the village show up at the top of the shoreline and all their little faces are peering over and they're just looking at you, wondering why you're there.
I love how the kids just migrate to you and you don't even have to know them. And they'll just want to start playing with you. They'll want to start, you know, shaking your hand, giving you hugs, giving you high fives.
One, two, three, here you go. One, two, three, four. I declare a thumb war. No.
It's pretty cool just to be an American in their world.
Oh, he got me. High five, you got me. Good job. Oh, bad to the bone. Yeah. Cool.
We're able to meet with the village leader. He said they'll make an announcement throughout the village and begin to gather the people. And he said we were welcome to share about our God.
So while we were waiting for the people to gather, the pastors that brought us here started telling us more about the witchcraft that's practiced in this region. They told us this one story about a man who had become possessed.
At like 3 o'clock in the evening, he just lost his mind. You know, he went in and it was raining and he went in the mud and started to eat in the mud and like an animal, you know, like a pig.
He said he believes he became demon-possessed. He had a little video of it on his phone that he showed to us of what the guy looks like. They took him home and they had to tie him up with ropes because he was so crazy. And then they called for the witch doctor. He said that's what everybody does down here.
My parents just go to witch doctor to heal him. They have a cow. So what they're doing now with the cow is they're going to sell the cow to pay a witch doctor. He tell the parents they need 4 cats. So he going to kill this cat, sacrifice this cat. He going to use this cat blood to heal this guy. But nothing happened. He just like fooling the people. And he was charging like $900 to heal this guy.
It's just so sad how little these people know and that they get taken such advantage of by these witch doctors who can't do anything.
That is the reality in the river here, and it's a challenge.
After hearing the stories about what these villagers deal with, I was eager to share the life-changing gospel with them. I began by explaining to them who Satan was and that all evil came from him.
He wants to keep us separated from God, our creator, who loves us.
Satan dia wan basika within dawan ya wan kumi bani rawan paskan bawin adag biwan saki leho rawan saka wansa.
But God, who created every human being and loves every human being, he sent his son Jesus to the earth.
All the people listened really intently as John shared the gospel with them, and the majority of them prayed to ask Jesus in their heart.
Then right now, just say this prayer to Jesus. And mean it with your heart. I believe he died for me. Jesus. I make you my Lord.
So I wanted to turn it over to Pastor Emil because he is the one that's going to be able to follow up and continue teaching these people how to truly, truly follow Jesus in their day-to-day lives, how to be disciples. It's so important that they now learn the rights and privileges that they have in Jesus, so they're not afraid of the evil spirits, so that they know that their families can be blessed and healed. And so that's why I've given him time to share these things.
After saying our goodbyes, we drove a little further to a second village, and this time I was gonna share. Man, I was excited to preach to those people. You know, there was like a row of kids like right in front of me. And so I kind of used some of the people that I was preaching to in the illustrations. He created you.
Within Bandera May Pascan.
He created you.
Bandera May Pascan.
And he created me.
One kumi bandera lat, one keikisa.
He didn't want to be separated from us.
Within wanta piakanyawan wina dakwitakaya.
So I was like, God wanted to be close to us. I got a, you know, a guy like right next to me. It was neat to be able to, you know, just kind of pull up to the side of the river, climb out, and then get out there and preach it to him.
And they put nails through his hands.
Si lakmitara mankan.
And they hung him on a cross.
And
then Jesus died.
These people don't even have cell phones. They don't have satellite dishes. They got nothing. They're just on the side of the river in a couple huts. And so the odds of someone, you know, getting the gospel to them is super small.
You know, Jesus died for each and every one of you here in this village.
You know, the prayer of salvation is like a really amazing thing, just because it's only like 5 or 6 sentences, but it's enough to change someone's eternal destiny.
Jesus!
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 Be my Lord!
Be my Lord!
What seems like such a little thing, you know, saying a prayer, it's really making a big impact in their lives.
Corey had just got done doing the salvation prayer, and then there's this guy, this random guy walks up with a guitar and he starts playing music. It was not very beautiful to hear, but it was beautiful in a sense that he was really, really trying.
By Jesus Christ,
it's kind of the most awful yet awesome noise like I've heard, because, you know, he's strumming it, it's out of tune, he's off key, and yet, you know, he's singing this song for us, you know, and to thank us for coming to his village. To get to, you know, randomly show up at some village in the middle of nowhere and just in 10, 15 minutes preach the gospel and get all of them saved. You get to be a part of that just by getting out of the boat and doing it.
This day you asked Jesus into your heart. And that means we are brothers and sisters. And someday we will see you again in heaven.
And you come your own prawa is a heaven.
Okay?
Bagusa.
Not many people can say that they've done something like that in their life. And the fact that I get to do it 4 or 5 times a year, man, that's like really cool for me.
Bye.
Bye-bye. How do you say bye again?
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Aisabe. Aisabe.
Aisabe.
We came to another village and we started interviewing the people to see kind of what they believed in and what their thoughts were on the different rumors that we've heard.
Are there mosquito people that turn to witchcraft or to powers of darkness or magic in order to try to get cured?
Yes, they practice. You know, they practice which they just go to the witch doctor. No, there are no medicine, no
available.
Drugs available. So the solution is to the witch doctor. But she was saying something interesting that she said that when someone gets sick and they come to the witch doctor, they die. You know, they doesn't give you a solution.
I was amazed to hear this lady admit to us that the witch doctors give them no good solutions. Having little access to medicine, though, time and time again, they'll turn back to these witch doctors, even knowing the end result could be their own death.
Sometimes the witch doctor or this guy then practice witch stuff. Like, you see right now she's pregnant. They do some darkness activities and stuff like that, and they like bonding this baby, so they can have baby. That is a system, a belief system in the community.
How about this mermaid? We've heard something about if someone dies in the river, or that it's a mermaid spirit or something. Could ask her about this.
She said that yes, they believe it. The witch doctor, they just come to the river, and they get in agreement with Satan, and they sell the people them life to the mermaid, and the mermaid just take you, and that was it.
But it's usually instigated. It's brought on by the witch doctor joining together with other witch doctors, or just with Satan himself, and they make a deal and say, we're going to curse this person.
Yeah.
The mermaid will take, we're offering them as a sacrifice to the mermaid.
Yeah.
Well, right there, who was the witch doctor making a deal with? Was it God, or was it Satan? What power is the witch doctor using if it's not God's power?
I was asking them these very direct questions to try and help them understand what power the witch doctors were actually using.
Satan.
Satan.
Yes.
Satan Karnika wants it. Yeah, they want to exhibit some Satan power.
So why would anybody go to a witch doctor when they're getting their power from Satan, the enemy of every human being, the one that wants to take us all to hell, Satan?
If you go to the witch, hold him, sell your soul, your life to the enemy, he can release you again.
He can?
He can, yeah.
I gotcha.
I found that many of these people don't turn to witchcraft because they want to. They do it because it's all they've ever known. But no matter how confused their beliefs may be, the best thing is just to share with them the simple gospel.
We want to share with you about the one true and living God. He's more powerful than any other power on this earth. Jesus made a way for you to become a child of heaven, a child of God, so that when you die, you will go straight to heaven to live with God forever.
John preached the gospel, and not for very long at all, like 5-10 minutes tops. I think after hearing us preach the truth of the gospel, they realized, you know, they'd rather have what we have to offer than all these other witchcraft things.
Say Jesus.
Who is Jesus? Man on the Sinai is Jesus.
Come into my heart.
Yang kupira baldims.
Take away my sin.
Yang kasaklukis naman badawan.
I make you my Lord.
Yang dawan kibaku may daw kisna.
Make me a child of God.
Yang lupiam kumbaku ay bris.
How many was it the first time you heard the story of Jesus like this today?
This is the first time someone coming from next
from the outside came.
We asked them, have you heard the gospel like this before? You know, in this way, the story about Jesus, and they said no. What a crazy thought. Like, how many other little villages along this river are like that nobody's ever been to? They've never heard the gospel. I feel good about what we did today, but it makes me realize how much more work there is to do out there. That's why people really need to get out there and start doing the same thing too, so we can reach people like this.
You don't have to be afraid of death. You don't even have to be afraid of evil spirits or the mermaids or witchcraft. You have Jesus inside you now. He is the all-powerful spirit. Guys, you're not gonna believe this. We are stranded.
When John told us that we have to stay the night in this village, I was kind of upset because I haven't eaten all day, so I'm pretty starved.
They said even if we try to find a beach, there's no way with how dark it's getting, if we're gonna be able to even tell if it's mud, and the boat would totally just sink and we'd get stuck and just be a mess.
I'm all up for adventure, and I'm sure this will be fun, but they don't call it the Mosquito Coast for nothing, because as soon as the sun started going down, these monster mosquitoes are like everywhere.
The bugs.
Our buddies took our boat with all of our DEET and bug spray in it to go get us some ramen noodles or whatever it is they eat here. Oh, did you see that?
Trying to ward off the plethora of mosquitoes all around me. I'm talking all around. It's like a stinking small cloud.
Bugs the size of my hand were like crawling on my arm and biting me. Not just bugs, mosquitoes, which If you know me, you know that mosquitoes are my pet peeve, and I hate everything about mosquitoes.
So,
we are stuck here right now on the mosquito coast with no bug spray, which is lovely, and I'm sure we'll have a grand night.
It was so hot. I mean, it was almost like suffocating hot, and we had to close the windows because all the mosquitoes.
I think the quicker we can start hanging nets, the better. Just, I don't know how long that light lasts.
And the bad thing about mosquitoes, they're kind of like nature, grass apart. They find a way. No matter what, mosquitoes find a way.
Look how low John's.
So mine's extremely low.
Well, man, you're just dripping sweat because you're hanging mosquito netting, cutting cord, and then on top of all those things, you're spraying DEET on, and you're so desperate not to be bitten by mosquitoes, you go against all the rules, all the little things on the back that say don't spray it right on your skin. I mean, we're all spraying it.
Getting that DEET on you, bro?
Because you're not supposed to put 100% DEET on your skin.
Especially sunburned skin.
Read the label, dude.
Thank you.
100% DEET is not for your skin, it's for clothes.
Holly is the queen of telling us things that we shouldn't do. So I'm putting 100%, I'm like, hey, I need some 100% DEET. I'm tired of these mosquitoes, give me some DEET. So I'm like spraying it on my skin. Holly's all saying, you know, you shouldn't put that 100% DEET on your skin, it's bad for you. And I'm like, dude, I don't even care.
I would drink DEET right
now. This is mine.
Pete.
You don't have, this looks like a
shirt. You know, that might work, guys. I'd be willing to sleep on the floor, I think.
John would be willing to take Corey's mosquito netting, is what he's saying.
Yeah, I toted it around 5,000 miles.
I would have also. Corey, he's with the kids all night.
Their voices will fade, but Brother John's snoring will not.
Oh, dinner!
Yes. There's two more.
How they found ramen noodles in the jungle, I do not know, nor probably do I want to know. I'm glad they got a soup because I was freezing. I was enjoying every single bite until Blake came up with a light and I could see that my bowl full of delicious ramen noodles was not only full of ramen noodles, but it was also full of bugs. Look. Dude, they're fully bugs.
So good.
Oh gosh, there's so many.
Holly, we're not complainers here at Global Ventures.
I'm not complaining, I'm just picking the bugs out.
My name's Holly and I'm too good to eat bugs.
Well listen, I've already eaten a bunch. I just didn't feel like eating any more.
Mine doesn't have any bugs in it.
This one's for you, Corey. This one's just for you.
Can I take that back?
I'm going to attempt sleep tonight. Obviously, that's the key word, attempt.
Some people really think camping out's fun under mosquito nets. They've never done it in Nicaragua. I can guarantee you that.
It's not so much the concrete that my butt is smashed up against. It's the profuse continual sweating that's going on.
I'm not that uncomfortable because I brought a sleeping bag like I was told to.
Okay, well I'm really tired and I'm ready to go to sleep because we just had like a 16-hour day and I'm ready to get up at 4:30 in the morning.
It's been a good day. The bug-covered ramen noodles topped it all off pretty well. And I'm looking forward to a grand night of sleep under my mosquito netting.
We will prevail because I took two Tylenol PM.
My mosquito net broke and it's laying on my face. Help. Someone help. First became a Christian, you know, and I gave my life to God, that has a real literal meaning to me. Like, I gave my life to God, my life is His, and so I have to spend my life being about what God wants me to do, and that's preaching the gospel.
What really impacted me is to just see your heart and passion of not waiting just as you had a group around you. You just really went for it. I think that was a great learning lesson for us, and the passion that we should have for sharing the word of God.
Sleeping out in the jungle, a little village, like those things aren't comfortable. They're not always fun, but it was only a day. And we saw over 150 people saved. That's amazing.
The people that was really receiving, you know, that was open to the gospel.
I travel and I share Jesus with people because if I don't go, who will? God's just looking for willing people, willing hands and willing feet to go and to spread the good news of Jesus.
I can't just, you know, go to church one day a week. That's not enough for me. You know, I need to go out into places where people have never heard about Jesus one time in their life, and I need to make sure that their eternity's set. They know where they're going and that they're going to heaven.
We would like to plant church in these communities, and it was really encouraged for them. They was like happy, joyful, you know, and they were sharing, said that they're really glad someone can visit them. So I believe it was really good.
I really missed my boys and Martine. But what is that in light of eternity? To make a difference in so many people's lives being changed and them winding up in heaven. I mean, that's where it's really at. Showing your children that there's something greater that your whole family can live for.
I really thank the Lord that you all took the aggressiveness to come down and were willing to do this trip. Thank you all very much.
When you give to touch people's lives, he gives it back to you.
These people are just forgotten by the rest of the world. Who's gonna take them to the gospel if we don't? How will they ever hear about Jesus?
You know, not many people go to places like this to do ministry. Maybe some people to go do humanitarian aid and you know, digging wells and giving clothes, which is good, you know, we need that. But we would be doing the people an injustice if we didn't share the gospel with them.
They're gonna remember us. They're gonna remember the day that those funny looking white people came to their village and told them about God. They're gonna remember the day that their lives were changed forever. And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we're gonna see them one day in heaven.
I don't wanna do anything else.
There's nothing else that I would rather do. There's nothing else I could do with my life.
When you step out and begin to share the gospel, God gets involved because you're fulfilling His great commission. I want to encourage you today, target people that haven't heard the gospel, go and share with them, and then step out of your comfort zone. Go to the other side of the planet to share the gospel with those that haven't had the opportunity that we do in the Western world. And you'll see God do tremendous things through you.
Our main goal in making Desperation Speaks was to find people in desperation and to really capture that moment where you can see their greatest need. This book is filled with photos of unreached people. Many of these were taken right at the point where they were hearing the gospel for the very first time. We wanted to create something that would really move you every time you opened it, and we hope that these emotional pictures and inspiring quotes will help keep a passion for the lost burning in your heart. Desperation Speaks is really so much more than a window to a world in need. It's a reason to do something about it. When you buy this book, not only will it be a blessing to you, but it will help us carry the gospel to more unreached nations of the world.
The soul of every human being, there's that nagging fear that they have not done enough because no one can do enough. If you want this freedom through Jesus, we can give it to you right now. We're gonna lift you up.
Look, he's bending at the knee. Look at this.
The greatest thing that I could have given him that day is Jesus.